listening to the Christian Jason. Dun, dun, dun. Featuring Mag.
No, honey, it's featuring Deej.
Featuring Maggie on WCOM, LP, Chapel Hill, and Carrboro.
Are you excited about our guest tonight, Laurie Shuman?
I don't know Laurie Shuman.
She's an international woman of mystery.
What's mystery?
Like, she does a lot of cool things.
Cool, like what?
She flies all over the world.
She has wings?
No.
Or in an airplane?
In an airplane.
Cool. I've been in an airplane a couple times.
Where have you gone in an airplane?
I've gone to Columbus and Dayton and Seattle. I've been to San Diego.
Wow.
And I've also been to San Francisco, and I've also been to Chicago.
Are you ready to start the show?
Not yet.
Well, we're running out of time.
Okay, then the show must go on!
All right, here we go.
I walked down by the riverside one evening in the spring. Heard a long-gone song from days gone by, blowing in on the great north wind. Though there is no lonesome cornerstone's cry of sorrow and delight, you can hear the cars and the shouts from bars and the laughter and the fights. May the ghosts that howl around the house at night never keep you from your sleep. May they all sleep tight down in hell tonight or wherever they may be. And the sun went on, though the lights were gone, and the north wind gently sighed. And an evening breeze coming from the east that kissed our riverside. So I pray now, child, that you sleep tonight when you hear this lullaby. May a wind that blows from hunting grains never bring you misery. May the angels bright watch you tonight and keep you while you sleep.
Good evening, friends. Good evening, Deej.
Good evening, Christopher.
How are you, sir?
Feeling all right. You know, I got my dog here with me. Got a nice backyard. I don't feel too cooped up.
You got Lily.
You know, it's easy to like focus on all the negative things, and I try to focus on the neutral things.
I love how you didn't go like I'm trying to focus on the positive. You went I'm trying to focus on the neutral.
Yeah, it keeps you even. Yeah. Yeah, but you know, one of the worst things about lockdown / quarantine is like you can't really travel anywhere. You know, like you go to Target or Harris Teeter once a week, but like can't go visit mom. Can't go on a vacation. Definitely can't go to another country for pleasure.
Your wings are clipped, Deej.
Wings are clipped, and it's I miss my mom. I want to go visit her.
I miss your mom. Wait, I shouldn't say that. That's weird. Anything anybody says about anybody else's mom is weird. I apologize for that.
Unless your mom is Margaret Thatcher.
Well, you know what, Deej? I'm happy to see you. We've got a great show tonight for our audience. I'm really excited about our guest. But yeah. Before we get to that, let's welcome in friends. As you know, people are listening from everywhere.
Anywhere at all.
To steal your line, they could literally be anywhere.
Literally.
But let's say hello to friends, Deej, who may be listening in Bexley, Ohio.
Bexley, Ohio, also known as CMH.
CMH, yes.
CMH.
Welcome, CMH. Brooklyn, New York, Deej.
Brooklyn, LaGuardia.
And we always want to say hello to our huge fan base in Chicago, Illinois.
Midway and O'Hare.
And O'Hare.
Can't be greedy.
Deej, are you a Midway guy or an O'Hare guy?
So when I was a kid, there was this comic cartoon called Captain Bucky O'Hare. It's about this like rabbit that lived in space
Captain
for some
Bucky
reason.
O'Hare.
Yeah. Had a pretty baller theme song. Okay. When I found out there was an airport named after Captain Bucky O'Hare, I was Team O'Hare for life.
That's perfect because Jess and I are Midway all the way. There's no turf war here, folks. DJ has O'Hare. The Amsbury's had Midway. I think everyone's had.
They had O'Hare, Amsbury.
And of course, Deej, we would be remiss if we did not say hello to our friends. And so do you think folks living in Geneva, Illinois, fly in and out of O'Hare or Midway, Deej? Do we need to like consult a Google Maps or something?
I think we need to have a Genevan on the show and find out.
I'm glad you say that. I've got Carrie Hyman coming up soon.
All right.
But anyway, and then also, of course, Burien, Washington.
SeaTac.
Washington.
Gorgeous airport.
So yeah. Burien is closer to the airport than Seattle is.
Huh.
It's this really cool little, like, I guess you'd say suburb of Seattle, a softball throw away from the airport.
Now, there's a unit of measurement I can understand.
Yeah, I wanted to speak your language, Deej.
Yeah.
I always like to try to get you involved in the show early and often. Let's see who do we have. Hey, look who it is. Ladies and gentlemen, Deej, welcome. She's an international woman of intrigue, Laurie Shuman.
Hey, Laurie.
Oh, thank you.
DJ, this is my legendary friend, Laurie Shuman.
Legendary.
I thought I was your legendary friend.
All right. Well, listen, I'm among two legends right now. So.
Okay, all right. There can be two legends.
So, Deej, Laurie and I met in Columbus, Ohio. We worked for the same company.
Yeah.
And that was a long time ago. It was your first job.
That was my first job. Yeah, out of college.
At Ricasso Financial Group. DJ, Laurie was recently quarantined. Was that in your home in Chicago?
Yeah. Yeah.
Are we allowed to say that you live in Chicago? Or
yeah. Yeah, I've always wanted a stalker.
Hmm. Oh, I'm way too lazy to stalk anyone. So
yeah, DJ's too lazy, but now our audience, though, who knows?
Yeah. I mean, I want the kind that buys me presents.
I went to Ohio State randomly, so I lived in Columbus for a few years also.
Oh, Ohio's great. I lived right down the street from Ohio State.
Okay. Yeah, I lived on Indianola Avenue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very nice. That's a great part of town.
Oh, I'm excited. Also lived on East 11th. I was there in like 2001. When I was there, there was a gravel lot with a chain. Like, that's all that was on that corner. Like, a chain, so nobody tried to get on the gravel lot.
Were there horses back then?
No, just gravel.
Columbus has changed tremendously, though. I mean,
I haven't been back in a long time.
I was going to ask, so your folks probably still live in Bexley?
They're there in the summer, but they spend most of their time in Florida now.
Oh.
Sounds like my mom.
They've reached an age where they spend part of their year in Florida.
They're officially old Jewish people.
Ah, as our Deej's.
Makes sense.
Columbus has, I mean, I always loved it. I go back periodically, Lori. I mean, maybe once or twice a year. And it really has come a long way. I mean, Columbus is fantastic. Except the weather.
It. It's no different than Chicago.
So Laurie Shuman is in, Laurie S, sorry about that.
That's okay.
Security clearance. Laurie S is in Chicago now, Deej, and she used to live in Queens.
Yeah.
Yes.
My mom's from Queens.
Oh, what part?
Forest Hills?
I was right outside Forest Hills in Regal Park.
Oh, yeah. All right.
Laurie, you're an international phenom.
Yes.
You travel all over the world. What is the most interesting city you've ever been as part of your career?
Probably Edinburgh, Scotland.
Scotland.
It was very cool.
Did you try the haggis?
I did not, but some of my crew members did, which I found disgusting.
Yeah, it sounds disgusting, but you just eat it.
They said it was disgusting.
Okay.
How long?
I would try it.
How long was I there?
Yeah, is it like, I'm so fascinated by the daily life of a flight. For example, I assume if you're going somewhere as far away as Edinburgh, Scotland, is there some downtime in the city and then you're back on the air, or one night and then up the next morning, or...
It varies super heavily. On that trip, I was there for 33 hours, which is a really awesome layover. But you can be internationally for as short as 12 hours. Domestically, the longest, you have to be somewhere for 8 hours, which people always think that sounds great, but you have to sleep.
Yep.
A really good layover domestically is 18 hours.
So just enough time to like sleep.
Just enough time to sleep and do something.
Have a meal, hang out a little bit.
Maybe see something.
If you know anybody in that town, maybe go visit them.
Mm-hmm.
But you're all the way to Edinburgh, Scotland, and you said 33 hours.
Yeah.
So like a full day of downtime.
Yeah. Usually on those, like take an hour nap and then do everything I can because you never know if you're going to make it back.
Yeah.
And then get a night's sleep and work back. It's usually a red-eye flight home.
Wait, what do you mean you never know you're going to make it back? Because there might be a global pandemic or...
Yeah, exactly. No, because it's all by seniority. And the seniors do. Most of the seniors work the international flights. Like I did Edinburgh. It was literally my first month flying. So that was 4 years ago. I haven't been back since.
Are you a senior now?
No. Senior people are like 40 years in. I've been flying 40? For 4 years.
Wow.
My seniority number is 24,004, which means there are 24,003 flight attendants more senior than me.
So they all have to retire or die.
Hopefully.
And then.
Laurie is on record as saying she hopes that her colleagues die so she can climb it.
I would be seniority. I wouldn't have got to Edinburgh again.
Oh,
it just
my
says
God.
What we're all thinking.
Early on in your career, you nail a pretty sweet gig.
Yeah, I just got lucky. Yeah. We have a system where you can bid for trips or you can pick up something that someone is dropping. And I just happened to get that.
The less seniority, it's Raleigh to Charlotte, RDU to CLT.
The super short ones are regional, which they wear our uniform, but they're not actually considered our company. And they're on the teeny tiny little planes where there's 50 to 100 passengers. I can't even work on those flights. It would be more like Chicago to New York to Dallas to Charlotte in one day. And then like a 8 or 10 hour layover. And then the next day, Charlotte to DC to Chicago to Miami. Mm.
How do you keep your head on straight? Because like we were talking earlier, so you're in Central Time.
Yeah.
You could be in 3 or 4 time zones in one day.
Having a cell phone that changes time zones automatically. I don't know how the flight attendants did it before that, where they had to know where they were and what time it was. Thank God I can just take my phone out of airplane mode and then suddenly that's what time it is. Mm. I would be late all the time otherwise.
Oh my gosh. And also, you know who I think would have a really, really difficult job? Well, really every job connected to the airline business is difficult, but could you imagine Deej, the scheduler? The person that's like, okay, my job is to schedule all the flight attendants, all the pilots. Let's see. I got Laurie S. I got to get her from Chicago to LaGuardia to Memphis to Dakota to Edinburgh, Scotland. And then she's got 15-hour layover. And the scheduling must be a nightmare.
I would love to be a fly on the wall and see what they do, especially in a time like now when things are canceling left and right and people are being reassigned all the time. I'm so curious how that works.
You think they even like take into consideration anything, or do they just pick anyone who's available, or do they make sure to pair you or not pair you with a certain coworkers?
You can buddy bid, but that could lessen your seniority if you're bidding with somebody less senior than you. But in general, if you're just bidding by yourself, it's supposed to all be seniority based, even if you're on call. Every other month we're on call.
Hmm.
Or you just basically sit by your phone. You know, if somebody calls out sick or doesn't show up for a trip and they just call you, you get 2 hours notice.
Can you like reverse buddy bid? Like there's
like, I don't want to be with this
you
person.
Can. Yeah. You can.
What's that called? Like
I don't know the exact word for it, but basically you just put them in your do not fly list.
Let me tell you something, Lori. I would insist on being with DJ Simons as my buddy.
He'd be your buddy better.
For anything air related. I promise you
that. Oh yeah.
He's got a coffee mug at his house that says Hebrew Hottie.
Yeah. That was a gift. You can't get yourself a Hebrew Hottie mug. That'd be weird.
You like can, when, but people would make fun of you.
Yeah.
Like when Michael Scott got himself
the world's a gift best
that says world's best mug. Yeah.
I also used to play on a softball team called the Hebrew Hammers.
Nice. That was a movie.
It predated the movie. It was actually named after a ball player, Hank Greenberg, who was nicknamed the Hebrew Hammer. So we all kind of stole the idea from
someone. But did the movie steal the name from you or from the ball player?
I believe the movie came out after our team was founded, but Hank Greenberg played in like the 30s, so it's all old.
See, Lori, this is the kind of nonsense we talk about on the radio show.
My brother's group of friends in high school were called the Jutang Clan.
Ooh, that's pretty good.
They had hats.
Yeah, nice. Good for him. What's your favorite airport code story? Like, why is it called that?
I didn't memorize the reasons on the list. They had the reasons, but I didn't get into why. There were so many that we had to memorize. Okay. I was just focused on what they were.
So a couple I thought were weird were Cincinnati is CVG because it's in Covington, Kentucky.
Oh, interesting. Huh.
But like, just call it Sin, right? I don't know. Oh, then Toronto is YYZ.
All of Canada starts with a Y.
Okay.
Why is that, Lori?
I don't know.
One that I think is lame is Nashville starts with the B, B-N-A. And I'm sure the NA is Nashville and the B maybe means something, but why?
Some of them are from what the airport used to be named. Some are after like the people that, I don't know, pay for it or whatever, design it. There is a reason behind all of them. But the only one that I know the reason behind is LAX. Used to be just the LA airport. And then when they decided that all of the codes have to have three letters, they just put a random X on the end.
That's what I thought it was. And I someone corrected me and said there was another story. But I think you're right.
I'm always right. No, I'm just kidding. I am right about.
My money's on Laurie S. for this one. Ballpark, how many international cities have you been in?
Actually, I have a list of...
Oh, that's even better.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Deej, this is the most prepared guest we've ever had.
This is just my personal. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18.
We're used to people just winging it.
23 yeah. countries.
Laurie S. has been to 23 countries. Deej, yeah. what do you think about that?
That's pretty good. That's more than I've been to, for sure.
That is 20 more countries than me. Wait.
I bet you'd be surprised if you actually sit down and think about it.
23 countries, Shuman, and how many cities across the United States? Just ballpark.
Almost all of them.
All of them. What's the smallest airport you've ever flown in and out of?
I don't know.
Charleston, West Virginia. Yeager.
No. Where is that?
Charleston, West Virginia.
What's Yeager?
It's called Yeager because of Chuck Yeager.
Oh.
Oh, I've seen Jägermeister.
Laurie, you're an aviation star. You should know who Chuck Yeager is.
I'm qualified on a lot of the bigger airplanes, so I don't do teeny tiny airports.
I know. I'm just thinking of different things. But here's what everybody wants to know, Laurie. Let's get back to that. We all have bad days, right? You're just in a bad mood.
Uh-huh.
Or someone on the flight ticks you off or is just a pain in the butt or whatever the case may be. Have you ever pointed to the exit rows but just used your middle finger?
I have not. And actually, we are not allowed to point to the exit rows anymore like they used to because it's considered offensive. So for a while, they just pointed and then they started pointing with two fingers and then they put it up to the whole hand. And now we just don't point at all because in certain cultures, pointing is offensive.
Pointing is offensive.
Yep. Mentally, I have straight up given them the finger, but no, in reality, I have not.
No longer point at the windows.
Nope. We just stand there.
That is weird.
Can you point your elbow?
We don't. I have a feeling that's probably offensive in some culture. But maybe I'll suggest that to management.
Okay. Interesting to figure out what gesture is not offensive anywhere.
It seems like everything we do is offends somebody. The thumbs up is offensive in Australia.
I think after the whole pandemic, I think like we should, unify certain things.
Yeah, let's just all agree that thumbs up is fine. Middle finger's bad. Let's just agree. Universal.
On game. I'll start spreading the word on the plane.
And let's start adopting the fist bump as the international way to say hello because it's 10% of the germs of the handshake.
Well, didn't Fauci want that? I think he endorsed the fist bump or the elbow bash.
Is it Fauci or Fauci?
I have no idea. I've only been reading it. I don't watch a whole lot of videos of him.
I think it's Fauci.
Fauci?
I have no idea.
You're probably right. You have a TV.
Who knows? I do have a TV. Yeah, that makes me so smart. I think it makes me dumber. You're
connected and worldly.
Well, we're rich, Chris?
We're speaking with the most worldly person we know, Deej.
That's true.
Sometimes the flight attendants get on there as part of their announcements and they say, we're here for your safety first and foremost, but also for your comfort. Is what they're really saying, get your own damn Pepsi.
Yes. We're saying sit down and be quiet.
Sit down. It's an hour and 15 minutes. You don't need a beverage. Chill out.
Exactly.
I knew it.
Totally.
Seriously, because I don't know, most of our audience, I would say I'm included in this. I would guess DJ is included in this. We consider ourselves good passengers. You get on the plane. I don't bother people. Maybe you have to go to the bathroom, but you don't make a big production about it. But there's a lot of maniacs that fly, and those are who you hear about, right?
Yeah. Well, we can have one maniac, and that we don't see any of the other passengers. The one maniac is all we remember.
There might be 100 of me, but if there's one goofball, okay, Laurie. So let's get into that. What are some of the gross, weird, just goofball things that people do on the air? Just in general,
walking around with no shoes on is the number one. Like, I can't tell you how many people don't wear shoes or wear socks into the bathroom This is essentially a public bathroom with turbulence.
Walking around with no shoes, that's number one. Because it's dirty or for any other reason?
100 people on one flight go into that bathroom, and there could be turbulence, so there could be splashing. That's not water that's on the ground.
No.
Put your shoes on.
And that's 100 on that flight, not to mention the flight before.
Exactly, and, they never clean those. They just flush the toilet and spray.
Mm. If you could talk to every passenger at once and just ask them to stop doing one thing to make your life easier, what would it be?
It really depends on my mood. There are some days where we haven't slept and haven't eaten and we have 3 legs a day and everything drives me crazy. And then there are other days where nothing bothers me.
Yeah.
Okay.
I guess when we talk to you, take your headphones off. We have 200 people that we're talking to. So when you go, what? And then we say it again. And then you take your headphones off and go, what? That's now 3 times I've said it to you.
Right.
And then I have 200 other people that I have to do the same thing to.
Deej, you better be taking notes.
Always. That's right. Continuously.
Respect the friendly skies, Deej.
Yeah.
I just don't want to be, I truly don't want to be annoying. Like, listen, if you don't have peanuts, no worries. It's an hour. I don't need peanuts. You know, I'm fine.
I don't have peanuts because there's too many fake allergies.
Oh, I forgot about, that's right. Peanuts, bad example because of the allergies.
Yeah.
Oh, I love peanuts. Damn it.
Well, don't go on one of Shuman's flights. Laurie S's flights. The shoe thing is disgusting.
I
give you that. I consider that disgusting, but not like annoying. What about the people that like do yoga or punch the seat in front of them?
The punching the seat doesn't bother me. That might bother your fellow passengers. But the yoga is annoying because you're shoving your butt in our face. And it's not like our area is no bigger than where you're sitting. But at the same time, I understand as an occasional passenger how uncomfortable those seats are.
Let's talk about who gets which armrest. Your thoughts.
I think the middle seat should get the middle armrests.
Okay.
But a lot of people disagree with me on that.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like if you get stuck in the middle seat.
You're never stuck in the middle seat. You're paying for the middle seat.
I guess.
Boom. That was a Shuman drop. Because Deej, there's a reason you're in the middle seat.
There's a reason you're in the middle seat.
You slacked off and bought your tickets late.
That's or you just didn't pay for the aisle and the window. But it's still super uncomfortable, so you should be able to put your arms up.
With all that said, I agree with DJ. I do think the middle passenger should both in our armrests.
Yeah.
Although I love that Shuman bomb you just dropped.
It's true. The people sitting in the back row and the people sitting in the middle seat, you paid for that.
I like sitting in the very back.
Well, we like having you there.
Yeah, it's nice. I don't like sitting in the middle.
Nobody does.
I think I like aisle best.
I do too.
Yeah, it's just easy to get in and out. And I don't mind getting up for other people. That isn't bugging.
Same. I completely agree.
I don't mind the middle if the two people on either side of me are on the slender side.
Yeah.
I don't know. How
often does that happen?
Well, if it's my wife and daughter. That's the only time it happens.
One time I was, this is actually New Zealand, so I don't know if this would, they have different rules or whatever, but the guy in front of me was so heavy, he was pressing against the seat in front of me, and I could not put down the tray table because he's exerting so much pressure on the pin, I couldn't turn it. And I didn't know if I should say something or like what could be done, and I just didn't say anything and I didn't get to use my table. But
I've never heard of that happening.
Yeah, it was weird. I don't know if they have like wimpier pins over there or something, but
maybe
that's bizarre. I didn't want to embarrass him. I ended up not saying anything, but part of me is like, can I just ask him to just stand up real quick so I can put it down and then maybe like
I would have.
Yeah.
People need to be more vocal on planes, like in a polite way.
Yeah.
I'm with you, Deej. I have no desire to like embarrass or
No. I felt bad for him.
But you can also
there's a way to do it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. People a lot of times will come back to the galley and ask us to do things, and I think that's more embarrassing for them if you just nicely say something.
I'm just so bad at being tactful. Like, I'll sit there and try to think of the right thing to say, then I'll just blurt out the most blunt, factual thing to say, which is usually a terrible thing to say in almost any given situation. So
he does that to me a lot, Laurie.
Yeah, oh yeah.
When we have meetings for this show, it's just it's a bloodbath.
Well, that's why it works.
Barefoot in the bathroom aside, what is the most disgusting thing you've seen on an airplane?
I see a lot of poop and barf.
Just around?
People get sick all the time.
Yeah.
That altitude is hard on your body. And it is. People it is. Fly when they don't feel well, and then it's gross.
Just it poop is. And then, ugh, someone's got to clean it. Oh, yeah. You.
No. Never me. Janitor.
It just has to be.
Not in my job description.
It just has to be around you for some period of time.
Yes.
Oh, Lord.
We had someone poop on the jet bridge once.
Wow.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Pre or post flight?
Post.
Okay, so they were holding it in and they couldn't make it to the
I think that
restroom or.
I speculate that this person had swallowed a drug balloon or something and it ruptured in her belly because Ooh. She was digging through said poop and she was very out of it.
Are you
and
serious?
So I, yeah.
That's a good, plausible explanation.
Oh my gosh.
How common is it for people to join the Mile High Club?
I've never seen it happen, and I don't know. I think I know one person that said they saw it try to happen, but like the people chickened out. But those bathrooms are so small and so gross that I think most people are, I think those days are gone. Maybe in the older planes when they were a little bit bigger. Even on these newer planes, the MAX that's not working right now, even I can barely fit in there.
Older planes were so much bigger. I was at an air museum, and it was just the regular seats from a plane from, like, not that long ago, from, like, the 70s. It appeared to be so comfortable.
It was so nice. We had, when I first started, which was only 4 years ago, we had a 757 that was older to the point that the safety video was a VHS tape, and you'd play it, and then you had to rewind it. And the seats on that plane were so big and so comfortable.
Yeah. 4 years ago.
4 years ago. Those days are gone.
It's amazing. Is it true that a lot of flight attendants just like, you're never home, so 10 of them might live together just because you're always in the air or whatnot?
Yeah. It's called a crash pad where you'll have 10, 15 roommates, and there are hot beds and cold beds. And I've never done it, so I don't know which is which, but one is a bed that is only yours. No one else can ever sleep in. And the other one is like, if there's an empty bed, you sleep in it. I was too old for that when I started. I was in my mid-30s, so I needed my own place.
Right, but like the 23-year-old single, yeah. They don't care. They'll do whatever.
Right, and a lot of flight attendants commute by airplane. Someone will live in Columbus but fly work out of Chicago because all you do is check in at the airport and then get on the plane. So there's not really a reason to live here.
Hmm. But now if you end up in LAX with a 10-hour layover, you always just stay at the closest hotel?
No, we have long and short hotels, and the company books it for us and everything. So the shorter ones, the city will put us close to the airport if it's short. And then if it's longer, we get put in a nice area downtown usually,
right,
so that we can do stuff.
DJ, I do not want to be a scheduler of these people.
I think it'd be kind of fun.
They'd be like, where's Laurie Shuman? Where's Laurie Shuman? We're trying to fly out of Memphis. And I'm like, what are you talking about? She's in North Dakota.
Yeah.
From talking on the phone with them, they don't sound like they love it.
So it's someone's entire job just to schedule?
But it's a whole team of people.
Yeah. There are different types of schedule. There's hotel and limos. The people that get us, they call it limos, but it's like a shuttle. It's a car service.
Limo in air quotes?
Yeah. They get us from the hotel to the airport and then put us in the hotel. Then there's scheduling, who puts us on the plane, tells us where we're going. There's all kinds of different departments. There are so many employees in the airline industry.
How much of your last 4 years has impacted your daily life? And let me give you a specific example. Okay, you're from Bexley, which, by the way, we're huge in Bexley.
Hi, Bexley. So
welcome. Hello, Bexley. Deej, come on. Say hello to Bexley. No? Oh, just a wave? Deej, yeah. This is the radio, damn it. Okay.
Hey, Bex.
Lori, you're at an Ohio State football national championship game watching party. It's the end of the fourth quarter. The game's almost over. Do you find yourself asking people to put their tray tables up and return their remaining service items?
I go around and pick up trash.
Oh, that's a good habit.
Absolutely not.
You don't get on the microphone and say, everyone, can you please turn your electronics off? None of that?
Yeah. I carry a oxygen mask with me at all times, just in case. Nice. Just in case I fall.
Just in case me or Deej might need it.
Yes. My life is different in that it's totally different than corporate America, but my personal life is, I don't act any different. I don't like people as much.
Because you deal with them all day long.
All the time.
And so many of them are such pains in the ass. Not me, though. I think I really do. I'm bad at a lot of things in life, but I do believe I'm a good airline passenger.
I'm glad to hear that. I'll be the judge of that one day.
Mm-hmm. Ever since you got that job, I was so excited for you. And Jess and I both were like, gosh, I hope one. Every time I go to the airport, the thought passes through our mind, I hope we just run into Lori just once. It'd be cool.
I would love it. I hardly ever see people I know.
How often are you through CMH?
Yeah.
I've only been through there twice.
What about RDU?
You know, it's funny. My next trip that I have on my schedule, I was supposed to have a long layover there. And with all this stuff happening, it got canceled. I'm going to St. Louis now.
This show right here, the one you're on, normally we are a live show on Friday nights at 10 o'clock. We're in Carrboro, North Carolina, which is about 30 minutes from the airport. If you ever find yourself with a layover at RDU, we want on a Friday night, that's a lot of qualifiers. We really do want you to be on our show live. That'd
okay.
Be awesome.
I'll come visit.
Right, Deej?
Oh, yeah.
All right, I'll let you know.
Because it really is a real thing. We're not just making this up. It might seem like we're just making this up.
Is this a scam?
Oh, by the way, we do sell vacuum cleaners.
No, you guys trying to steal my identity.
Recently, your wings were clipped.
They were.
I've been waiting to say that the whole... Ever since I knew you were coming on. So, DJ, Lori officially got quarantined. So kind of walk us through that. And I do want to say to the audience, one of the best things about Lori's quarantine, she created a series of daily pictures with her colleague.
She's also a flight attendant.
Was she your roommate before all this?
No, she was a flight attendant friend in New York, and we transferred here together and got a place.
Okay, and what happened quarantine-wise? Walk us through it, Laurie.
I was exposed on a flight. One of my coworkers tested positive for the COVID, so I went into quarantine, the 14-day quarantine, just in case I was sick, which I never ended up having any symptoms, thus could never get a test. But during my quarantine, I got a call from my company saying that I was exposed a second time before that. So good thing that I was quarantined.
Yeah. But
now I'm not officially quarantined. However, there are no flights to work. So I've still been at home.
A lot of funny things have happened as a result of all this. That series that you did was one of my favorite by far.
Thank you. It gave us something to look forward to every night.
It really was. Deej, I'll show them to you. They're really
good. All right. Can't wait.
Lori.
Yes.
When? It's 2020. When are they going to stop telling us how to buckle a seatbelt?
I have actually had a passenger. This little old woman got stuck in her seatbelt. She couldn't figure out how to get out of it. And the whole plane emptied and she was still sitting there. And I went over and was like, are you okay? And she was like, I can't figure out how to get this off.
Oh, now I feel
so
bad for saying
we will
that.
Never stop.
It'll never happen, Deej.
It'll never stop. It is a necessity.
The inflatable super fun happy slide. Ever had to use that?
Oh, yeah. Just
I
once.
Have not, but in training, we went down it.
Was it fun?
It is so fast.
Yeah.
The reason that you're not supposed to take anything with you is because you go so fast. And if you take anything, you could topple over.
Oh,
but
geez.
It's crazy fast.
Wow.
I hope I never actually have to go down it.
Yeah. You know, someday when airplanes are obsolete and they've been replaced with superior technology, there should be like an airplane museum where you can like go down the slide.
I agree. I think it would be very cool if everyone got to go down it.
You moved to New York.
To Queens. And then I moved to Chicago.
We strongly considered Chicago. If Jess and I were going to live in a large city, Chicago is like number one on our list.
I hear good
things. I like Chicago.
Yeah. She went to Notre Dame, so a lot of her friends live there. And
oh, nice.
I would enjoy the second city. I like comedy.
Yeah, that's. I was supposed to go there right before everything shut down. I had tickets that they refunded.
It's great, though.
I've been to Chicago once. My friend asked me to DJ his wedding because my name is DJ.
You're the DJ.
I think that's where his mind went first. The wedding was in Chicago in January.
Oh.
So I wasn't really very excited to go, but it turned out to be unseasonably warm.
Nice.
And I was out in Elgin, Illinois. So I was kind of disappointed that it wasn't in Chicago. But Elgin was kind of nice. It wasn't too bad.
He duped you.
He did, and I learned how to DJ weddings, so I can do that now.
Add that to your long resume.
There's actually a lot more that goes into it. I thought I was going to hit play on an iPad and get drunk. You have to, like, be there and read the room, and, like, people stop dancing and sit down, and you take it personally.
Yeah. Did you wear headphones and go like this?
No, but I like a mixing table and everything.
Did you play the electric slide?
No. The bride gave me an iPad with, like, 100 songs on it, so I had to choose from those.
Why were you there again?
Because of my name. Yeah. Literally, that's it. But anyway, so like people danced the first one or two songs, and then they all sat down. I was like, oh, what do I do? And I literally Googled like how to make people dance when you're a DJ on my phone. And I found this really good website.
Yeah. Did a picture of Snoop Dogg come up or what happened?
Black Eyed Peas.
No. The main rule is you got to get the girls dancing. Because the guys aren't going to go up and dance without the girls.
Right.
And you got to play music from when the girls were in middle school. So most of the people at that wedding were born in 85. So I did the math. I'm like, okay, 98, NSYNC. So I just played a whole bunch of NSYNC in it, and it worked.
Well done.
Yeah. You have to change energy levels. You got to go high, medium, low, medium, high, medium, low. And have like a dud song in there every once in a while so people like can feel like they can sit down and take a break. So
eat a little prime rib.
Yeah, drink a little prime alcohol.
Yeah.
I feel like I could do it again, and the opportunity hasn't come up, but like I totally could.
DJ, you are a man of unlimited talent. Go see your parents. Go visit them. Come on, Shuman. They miss
you. I can't. I'm not even allowed in their neighborhood right now. Their neighborhood is like the Gestapo right now. They're checking IDs at the door.
Sorry, the one in Florida or the one in Bexley?
In Florida.
Oh.
Because everyone there is old? Is that why?
Yeah.
They probably live at the same place as my mom.
Probably.
So very familiar. Very Gestapo.
Yes. My parents were like, we didn't know we were elderly until this.
Right. So you are available, but the flights are down. So you're just kind of hanging out.
We're running at 15% right now.
What's next for you creatively? Because listen, you made that awesome series of posts, but Laura, you can't just do all that creative work and then just do nothing. Like,
what's we were going to quit while we were ahead.
Quit while you're ahead. Oh, but the audience wants more.
You want to go out at your peak like Seinfeld.
Laurie Shuman is the Seinfeld of COVID-19 Facebook posts.
You could keep going like Dexter, but like, just quit at the top.
I've had Dexter on a flight twice. He recognized me the second time.
Isn't he? I think he's from Raleigh.
Is he? I had him out of Chicago. I had him Chicago to New York and New York to Manchester, England.
Oh, cool.
So, celebrities. Let's do that. So Dexter.
Diana Ross. And Cardi B and Stevie Wonder.
Wow.
Nick Kroll seems like somebody you guys would like.
I don't know.
He's funny. I think it's an old man character he does with Mulaney.
He tried out for SNL and didn't make it.
Really?
Oh.
Lori, I love how you said, that seems like someone you guys would like.
He strikes me as somebody you guys would like.
Deej, we're typecast by Lori. Okay, DJ, celebrities on the same flight. Anybody?
Yes, two. One, you don't care about, he was my congressman at the time, Lewis Stokes. I think he was the first black congressman in Ohio or something like that. He was the first. And then, so him and John Cleese, which was so cool.
Did you talk to either of them?
No. I've never like gone up and talked to a celebrity because they don't care about
me.
You know? It's a very one-sided relationship.
It's like when your fans come up to you in the airport and you're like, God, it's hard being famous.
Or it's like asking a flight attendant for a second Sprite on a 1 hour flight. I'm like, come on.
So annoying.
You don't need a second freaking Sprite.
Such a pain. P.S. We have Sierra Mist.
Yeah. And by the way, we have Sierra Mist. Quit asking me for Sprite. Jess and I were on a flight with the Reverend Jesse Jackson.
Nice.
That's probably the biggest on flight.
Did you talk to him?
No, he was in first class.
Ooh.
We're way in the back. So no. The only celebrity I've ever like been around and talked to was Chris Farley. But
that's
like
a good one.
Yeah, that's a good, who I actually talked to, and we had a chat.
Wow.
It was amazing. Impressive. Yeah, yeah. It was me and my brother, Lauren, and my sister, Bridget, and my dad. Generally speaking, if I see a celebrity, I don't fan out. They're just a person. They're an actor. They're an athlete. Good for them. If we get into a chat, I'll chat with them, but like, I don't make a big deal about it. That's kind of
weird.
So the year the Columbus Crew won the MLS Cup was 2007. And I was on the flight back with the entire team on Southwest. Nice. It was cool. Frankie Haydick, he's kind of a known. People love him. He's like a fan favorite. I was in the aisle. Jess, me, right in front of us was Frankie Haydick. And this guy, Guillermo Barro Schiletto. He's like an international superstar in soccer. And he finished his career with the Columbus Crew. And he was right in front of me. So that was kind of cool. Laurie, where are you on the pecking order again? 22,600. What was that?
24,004.
Let's say a flight attendant gets a job today. What's their number?
I don't know. I've been flying. I just had my four-year anniversary. So there are 4 years worth of people below me. Probably
if you had
like
to guess.
28,000.
Okay.
Yeah.
1,000 per year, sounds like.
Around there, yeah.
I think you're climbing the ladder. And I think you're going to make it to the top, Laurie. That's my prediction.
That's the goal.
Deej, any thoughts on that?
I believe in you, Laurie. I think you have it in you.
I appreciate the support.
Is it not pretty much continuously updating every time a flight attendant anywhere retires or dies?
We get a new number like every few months. They send an email that says your number's been updated.
Will you check in with the show when you've broken 20,000? When you're 19,999, will you like send us a message?
Yeah.
We'll play 1999 by Prince for you.
Oh.
Celebration song.
Thanks.
Yeah.
All right. Do you still talk to Aaron and Amy? And
yeah, when I'm home, the three of us meet up.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're still great.
I haven't seen them in years, but I love them and they're good people. You know, and Mike.
You should call them next time you're home.
Here's my problem. When I come to Columbus, there's 30 people.
You still have a group.
Family and group and then Jess's family. And then there's 30 people I want to see. But all right, Laurie, one last chance. I really want to peel back the onion here. What is the most disgusting thing? Or just ridiculous that you've seen on a flight that we haven't already said tonight.
I used to work Haiti a lot when I lived in New York.
Haiti, and, she said, Deej. Haiti.
Haiti.
Yeah.
The country.
And I had a passenger ask me where the bathroom was. We were standing right in front of the bathroom. So it was like, just go in the door. And she went past the bathroom into the galley and was trying to open the aircraft door.
Nice.
And the pilot called back. I wasn't back there because I didn't think I needed to guard the door to the plane at 40,000 feet. So the pilot called back and was like, what is happening back there? I keep getting the light that the door's open. And I walk back and she's standing there trying to lift the door. I'm like, you gonna go outside and pee?
That's so
Haitian
awesome.
DB Cooper.
These are the stories. This is the kind of hard-hitting journalism on the Chris or Jenny show.
So I've seen things I never thought I would see.
All right. It's been an honor having you on the air.
Thanks for having me.
Any last words, Laurie?
Be nice to your flight attendants.
Simple. Just be nice to your flight attendants. EJ, any final comments from you, my friend?
No, there's nothing final. Thanks for coming, Laurie. It's good to meet you.
Thanks for having me. Nice to meet you.
Yeah.
See you, Laurie. Bexley. Thanks to both of you. Thank you very much, guys.
Bye.
Take care. Another time and space, a parallel universe is falling on its face. When out of the chaos, who else could it be? Fuck the animal adventurers from SPACE! Bucky! Captain Bucky O'Hare! Mutants and aliens and toads, beware! You're looking for adventure, well this is it! With Jenny, Deadeye, Blinky, and Willy to win! I said Bucky! Captain Bucky O'Hare! And now in the Pagan, Bucky O'Hare and the Toad Wars! In the battle of the universe, you don't know what's next. You only know amphibians have made it complex! You check out your scanner and the evil that it holds. There's only one course of action. Let's go for some toads. Bucky, Captain Bucky O'Hare. He goes where no ordinary rabbit would dare. If your righteous indignation has suffered a hit, and your photon accelerator is broken a bit, and you're losing your mind and you're having a fit, get the funky fresh rabbit who can take it.